legs. This is in rats. Whereas in females, they saw a decrease in spine density. Now, for the researchers, this was simply another example of sex differences in the brain, of which we know of many. But I, looking at these images horizontally, instead of vertically, noticed something else. I noticed that sex differences in the brain may be opposite under different conditions. In other words, what was typical of males under the no stress condition, which is low density of spines, was typical of females following stress. And what was typical of females under no stress was typical of stressed males. And I thought that this was really surprising. And I hope it is surprising to you too, but if not, just think of what would you feel or think if I told you the same story, but not about dendritic spines in the right hippocampus, but about genital organs. So what would you feel if you heard that 30 minutes of stress are enough to turn your clitoris into a penis, or your penis into a clitoris? Okay, now you are still a little afraid of me, so you're not really laughing. But you should, because this never happens in GT. But it does happen in the brain, quite often actually. So after I saw this first study, I started looking for other studies like this, and found several studies, or many studies, showing such reversals of sex differences in many regions of the brain, in many features or measures that we can take of the brain, and following many different manipulations. Even housing rats, one to a cage or several to a cage, is enough to reverse some sex differences in the cortex. And when you look at all of these studies together, what you can realize is that these interactions between sex and other factors like stress or housing conditions can be different for different brain measures. So the same manipulation that reverses a sex difference in one region or measure can abolish a sex difference or create a sex difference in another domain. And when you look at all of these studies together, these challenge the sex binary, and specifically the belief that there are male and female brains. And before I explain how exactly these challenge the sex binary and present an alternative to the sex binary, I want to talk a little bit about what we can learn from these studies. So when you look at these images, and these are all I'm talking about studies in rats, I will move to humans later. So when we look at these images, we can first learn that there are sex differences in the brain, and also that sex-related factors affect brain structure and function. And there are many studies showing that sex-related hormones, testosterone, estradiol, etc., affect the brain. Usually when we hear this, we immediately continue to conclude that this must mean that there are male and female brains. And what I will do today, or at least try to do today, is disconnect the two parts. Yes, there is lots of evidence that sex-related factors affect the brain, but as I will show you, this type of evidence suggests that these differences or these effects do not add up to create two types of brains, male and female brains. Another thing that we can learn from these images is that even though sex-related factors affect the brain, sex category, that is whether one is male or female, provides very little information of brain structure. And even if you look at these images, knowing, for example, that the rat is male doesn't allow you to predict whether they will have a high or low density of spines and receptors. Okay, so again, differentiate between the fact that sex-related factors affect the brain and the question of whether sex category provide information about the brain, a specific individual brain structure. Okay, so I said that, and I started to notice how these results challenge the sex binary. So let me just explain the general context. So first, why are we thinking sex, brain, and gender? You already understand. I will talk a little bit about the binary framework and how we usually think about the relation between sex and other systems, like the brain. And then I will go beyond the binary for the brain, for sex itself, and for gender. So let's talk a little bit about the binary framework. And I want to start with a quote from Veronica Sanz, who said, "The problem with the sex dichotomization into male and female brains stems not only from its biological reality. Structure and function. whether they do not represent the typical male and female brains, actually no one has such a brain. There is no person with a blue brain and no person with an orange brain. Instead, what each of us has is a unique combination of blue and orange connections. So what we wanted to do next is ask, so if brains are not male or female, the way we think about, usually about sex effects on the brain, then how best to describe the connections between sex and the brain? And specifically, we wanted to contrast the common way of thinking about the human brain as, you know, as we just saw that the brain type typical of men is different from the brain type typical of women, from what I, when I was looking at our results, started to think. And when you look at the green-yellow images, it seems that human brains not only do not belong to two types, but actually that we all belong into a single, highly homogeneous population of human brains, in which what's typical of humans, regardless of the sex category, is to have this unique mosaic of male typical and female typical features. Another thing that we can see is that there are some rare brain types, for example, yellow brains. Maybe you can see this better here. So there are some people with a yellow brain. There are very few people like this. But of the people that do have a yellow brain, there are more men than women. So if we put this together, what we said is that it seems that the typical, or the brain types typical of women are also typical of men, and vice versa, and this is to have a mosaic brain. But there are sex-gender differences in some rare brain types. And we wanted to test whether this is true, so we crossed the two descriptions of the relations between sex and the brain. Before I explain a little bit about how we did this, I just want to comment or to mention. Both descriptions, the one on the left and the one on the right, both descriptions rely on the fact that there are sex-gender differences in single brain features, whether there are density of spines or volume of specific regions. This is not the question. There are sex differences in specific brain features. The question is, how do they add up one to another in the whole brain? Do they add up consistently, as is happening in the reproductive system, to create two types of brains? Or are they mixing to create these mosaic brains? Okay, so the question is in the level of the whole brain, not in single features. And again, together with two professors from Tel Aviv University and a group of students, we applied several machine learning techniques to this question. Again, I'm not going to show you all of it, just one analysis. You can read the rest in the paper. And in this analysis, we used anomaly detection to ask whether the brain architecture typical of men are different from those typical of women, or they are the same. And anomaly detection is a method that was developed to detect worms and viruses in our computer. And the way it acts is it learns the normal, if you want, or the usual actions of your computer. And after it is trained, it runs in the background. And for anything that the computer does, it asks, is it a normal computer activity or abnormal computer activity? And if it detects an abnormal computer activity, it alarms you. And then maybe it's a worm, or maybe it's a new application that you downloaded. Okay, so it's not like an antivirus that you, or the one that you know, that we already know the virus and we are looking for it. This is an attempt to find something that we are just, is abnormal. We don't know how it will be abnormal, but it's just not normal. So what did we do with this? We used it to ask, to answer the question, so how does it work? Same, but first training on the brains of men. Now, what would be the predictions? Before we did the actual study, we wanted to make sure that this approach could detect two populations if these existed in the data. And we used the partial morphology of two primate species, so obviously two populations. And in all the analysis that I will show, we analyzed the data both in the highly dimensional regional space and following different methods of dimensional reduction, both linear and non-linear. And the idea here is just to make sure that the results or the conclusions are general and not specific to one type of analysis. Okay, so let's look at the results together. So I'll go over them with you. So let's first look at the case when the model or the algorithm was trained on the faces of macaques. And you can see that all the data points fall on the y-axis, meaning that the algorithm never classified a capuchin as a normal macaque. And similarly, when the algorithm was trained on capuchin, all the data points fall on the x-axis, meaning that the algorithm never mistakenly classified a macaque as a normal capuchin. So the algorithm does a very good job in distinguishing that there are two populations here, and never mistakenly classifies one as the other. Okay, what will happen when we do the same but now with human brains? So you can see that the results are exactly the opposite. Instead of being on the x and y axis, they are aligned along the y equals x axis, meaning that regardless of whether you train on the brains of men or women, the proportion of men and women classified as normal is very similar. And this was also true for another data set. Together, these studies show that the brain architecture typical of women are also typical of men, and vice versa. In another study using a different approach, we also showed that there are indeed some large sex gender differences in some rare brain types. I didn't show you the study, so you have to take my word for it or go and read the paper. And we also showed that sex category provides very little information on brain structure. Now this is a conclusion that you already heard by talking about single features. So we showed it for the whole brain, but it's the same principle. So to put it together, sex-related factors do affect also the human brain. The fact that some of us here have high levels of testosterone, some have lower levels of testosterone, and other differences that we have between us in our sex-related factors do affect our brain. But how they affect our brain depends on interacting with other factors. And this is why our sex category, whether we are males or females, doesn't allow you to predict our brain structure. And also it doesn't allow you to predict how one brain would be similar or different from another brain. In other words, the fact that I have female genitalia doesn't mean that my brain is more similar to your brain than to this person's brain. Okay, so we finished with brain. There are no male brains and female brains. Instead, we all belong classes of two types in terms of our hormonal system. And it's better to think about our hormonal system as multidimensional, highly dynamic and responsive, highly overlapping, and not as belonging to two classes. Let's go back to the sex differences we just found in whatever we were measuring. And of course, sex-related factors are not the only thing that can cause differences in whatever we are measuring. Many other factors that correlate with sex category, physiological variables and environmental variables, can be causing this difference that we are observing. And of course, in humans, we also have gender. Gender here, I mean, because there are many meanings to the word gender, so here I mean gender as a binary social system that attributes different meanings, status, expectations, power, etc. to humans with male and female genitalia. And all of these factors, they not only affect the endpoint, or can only also affect the endpoint, but they also affect one another. And I just told you how things like competition and parenting, highly gendered behaviors, can affect the level of sex-related hormones. And obviously, when you look at all of these factors together, they do not fall into two classes, male and female types of variables. Rather, each of us has a unique mosaic, which is constantly changing, of male typical and female typical levels in all of these different variables. So again, when you take a group of humans and divide according to the form of the genitalia or gender identity or whatever you want into two classes, the underlying variables that are relevant to whatever you are measuring, they do not fall into two classes. They are much more complex, they reside in a highly multidimensional space, and it's really wrong to think of them as belonging to two types. Let's go now and talk a little bit about gender, and now not as a social system, but rather at the intrapersonal level. As cognitive abilities, emotional abilities, personality traits, etc. And we are all, familiar with sex gender differences in humans between men and women, or females and males, in cognitive abilities, personality characteristics, behaviors, interests, etc. Most of these differences, especially in the cognitive, emotional, personality domains, are much smaller than you usually believe. But there are some large differences in behaviors and interests and attitudes. Again, I'm not concerned at all with how do we get to have these differences, whether this is nature or nurture, but only whether they add up to create two types of humans, men and women. And to answer this question, we used a similar approach to what I showed you in the brain. So we looked at several big data sets of thousands of humans, and in each data set we chose the variables showing the largest differences between men and women in that specific sample. And for each of these variables, we used this time a pink-blue scale. A pink for the scores that were more commonly women than men, so we can call them feminine scores, and blue for scores that were more commonly men compared to women. So let's just do one or two together to make sure that we all understand. So let's take worries about weight. So if someone was really worried about their weight, can you guess which color you get? Pink. Because in that sample, women on average were more worried about their weight compared to men. And if someone had high self-esteem, what color would this cell get? Blue. Yeah, you should go and do better work for gender stereotypes. So in that sample and in many other samples, men on average have higher self-esteem compared to women. And just a small comment, usually when you do find a gender difference in a sample, usually it will match some kind of stereotype that you were aware of. The reverse is not always true. So not every stereotype is backed by data, and it can be found in one sample, but not in others, in one country, but not in others. Okay, but the other way around is usually true. If you find differences, it will match some stereotype. Okay, so we did this coloring for each cell, saw. So men on the left, women on the right. There were more women. This is why they have two columns. And I remind you, each line here is 7 variables in this case, not 160 like you saw before. So each line is a single individual, 7 characteristics. And again, you can easily see the group level differences. There is more blue at the men's side and more pink at the women's side. Now it has to be this way because this is how we define what's blue and what's pink. Another thing that you can see is that there is quite a lot of pink in the blue and blue in the pink. And this represents the fact that for any known psychological variable, there is some overlap between men and women. Some men would be feminine in this variable and some women would be masculine. But this is all known. What we were interested in is whether humans are blue or pink. And as you can see here, there was not even a single individual who had all 7 variables in the masculine or in the feminine range. Instead, most individuals had a unique combination of masculine and feminine characteristics. And I'm sure you know this about yourself, so I'm sure everyone here can name at least one masculine and one feminine characteristic that they have. What maybe you didn't know is that everyone is like you. So you're not special in this respect. And I want to show you that this overlap and mixing is also true when we talk about variables that show the largest gender differences in humans, which is gender identity and sexuality or sexual attraction. So we ask people, how much or how often do they think of themselves as men, between never and always, and as women, between never and always. And this is what we saw. So you can see, and I don't want to go into the details, but you can see people with different gender identities, different sex registered at birth, and what I wanted to appreciate is how variable people are on these two scales. So of course we have people that always think of themselves as a woman and never as a man and vice versa, but many, many people, also cisgender individuals, many people think of themselves in terms of both being a man and being a woman. So also the binary frameworks through which we think of the experience, gender experience of normative individuals, normative in terms of their gender identity, is not accurate. And the reason is no one ever checked. Okay? So people were studying gender identity in transgender individuals, assuming that cisgender individuals just have a simple gender identity. Until we came a decade ago and actually asked people the two questions, how much they identify as men and as women, and then we found that there is much more deviance, or it's not a good word, there are much more of the gender experience of many individuals transcend the either or binary assumption. And this is a original study in 2013. Showing only cisgender individuals now, so you can better appreciate the degree of variability and overlap in cisgender individuals. And similarly for sexual attraction, if I ask you how attracted are you to men and how attracted are you to women, then the result would be something like this. So obviously they don't fall into 2 classes or 3 classes, but people can be everywhere on this domain, from being highly attracted to both genders, another gender, or being, you know, attracted to one gender and the other, etc. So again, I don't want to go into this in too much detail, but just show you how the binary framework, which is often assumed and rarely tested, is interfering with our ability to study and describe different phenomena, from the brain to sex itself, and also for the different psychological variables or experiences. And as Sue mentioned before, we've recently launched a website with a gender mosaic questionnaire in which you can actually explore your own gender mosaic. So it has different questions about job and activity preferences, aggression, gender identity, femininity and masculinity, and sexual preferences. And when you are done answering the questions, you can see how feminine and masculine you are on each trait. Now, obviously, what's feminine and what's masculine differs depending on the sample to which you compare yourself. So let me show you how we determine this. So let between unimportant, 0 and 4 indispensable. Let's keep this open, we'll have it. If we compare your answer to a sample of 1,500 people from Japan, you can see that there was a large gender difference in this sample. And for example, scores 2, 3, and 4 were more common in women compared to men. So we can consider them as feminine scores. And if your answer was 2, 3, or 4, then we will color the corresponding square in your mosaic in either pink or red. In contrast, answer 0 was much more common in men compared to women, so we can consider it a masculine response. And if your answer was 0, then you would be blue in this answer or in this square. Answer 1 was similarly chosen by men and women, so it is gender neutral. Neither feminine nor masculine, and we mark it as yellow. Simple. But now, what will happen if instead of comparing your answer to the answers of the 1,500 Japanese, we would compare it to 1,500 people from the USA? You can see that here, there is hardly any difference in how much men and women, how important it is that their romantic partner is rich. Making all answers gender neutral. So regardless of what your answer was, the corresponding square in your mosaic will now be yellow. And here you can see my mosaic, where my answers were compared to the American sample. Here is the same answers. I haven't changed, my answers haven't changed. The only thing that changed is what's considered feminine and masculine. So when my answers are compared to a Japanese sample and to an Israeli sample. And you can do that. We have already, I think, over 15 countries there, from many different interesting places in the world. So you can fill in your questionnaire, see your mosaic, and then see how it changes when you change the country of comparison. Now, obviously, I'm not the only one with a mosaic gender. So you can see the answers of many people that already answered the questionnaire. And you can see how variable each individual is in terms of gender mosaic. And now we can think of the fact that all this huge variability is forced into boxes by the binary gender system, into the boxes of men and women, boys and girls. And this is why we started this Substack, which its aim is to think of a world without gender. Without gender, not in terms of gender identity or gender characteristics, but in terms of this gender binary system that attributes again expectations, roles, etc. to humans with male and female genitalia. So you can go and visit this subject and see already several publications, and we are happy if you subscribe, it's for free of course, etc. And also if you're interested more about this, the way I imagine a world without gender, then you can listen to my recent TED Talks, which explain the reason for this future and how it may be. Another question, which is interesting, and I will almost end with this, is if humans are mosaics, as our studies show, and maybe as you already started to realize, then why, when we look around us, we don't see mosaics, what we see is men and women. So why do we perceive humans as if they belong to two types, when in fact they don't? And it's an interesting question. Why do we think Earth seems flat, but still we know that it's round? So it's an interesting question why it seems flat. And actually, it seems so flat that some people do believe it, it is flat. So again, I'm not going to explain, and if you want, you can read, because we recently wrote about this, but it's the same idea that what I started with the gender binary system and how it maintains itself in science. Similarly, it operates to maintain itself in society. So we have a binary gender system, the social level, and this leads to labeling, gender roles, etc. And this creates the illusion that we do belong to two types, etc., etc. So we have this self-maintaining system, social system, binary system. And an important element of this system or belief system is the myth or the hypothesis or the view that by no means new, a new myth. Actually, it can be traced back to the beginning of modern science. So already in the 17th century, when modern science emerged, it had the role to replace religion in explaining social order, not just the natural order. And one of the things that they tried to explain is inequalities in society, between men and women, but also between other groups, like the poor and the rich, black and white, and other colors, etc. And for at least for men and women, it seems like an easy task, because they soon realized that men had on average larger skulls compared to women. Now they didn't know then how to treat the human brain, so they couldn't take it out and measure it, it would just spill all over. But they realized that there is a relation between skull size and brain size, and they knew that the brain was important. So this was an easy solution. Men dominate because males are superior intellectually, because they have greater brains. This hold until they realized that some animals have a larger skull than humans, like whales and elephants. Obviously, the scientists, or male scientists, that wanted to explain why men are superior to women didn't want to conclude that whales are superior to men, obviously. So they had to find a solution. And they did. Very creative. And what they found is that if you look at the ratio of skull to body size, then the humans have the largest known ratio of the skull to body size. Okay, we can breathe again. But women actually have a larger skull to body ratio than men do. Okay, we have a problem again. So if you for 1 second even imagine, but I'm sure you didn't, that they just concluded, okay, so we must have been wrong throughout these centuries. And actually women are the more intelligent sex, because we had a theory, right? And we trust science. So women are the more intelligent sex, and therefore we need to change social order and let women rule, and then the world would be a better place. No, this didn't happen. And instead, they looked for other explanations, and in this case, one of the explanations was that in kids, the ratio of skull to body ratio is very large. So they said that so humans start from this large ratio, and then through development, this ratio gets smaller, and women, they just get stuck on the way. So they don't fully develop. So it sounds funny, but let's jump to the 19th century. So they already were able to study the brain and the regions of the brain, and they discovered that male brains are on average larger than female brains, and some scientists, really serious scientists, said that now we understand why women can't go to universities, not because they were not allowed, of course they weren't allowed, but because it was dangerous for them, their brains were small, too much blood to the brain, it can be dangerous. Some were worried that they would, that it will impair their reproductive abilities. Okay, there were many different reasons why women couldn't go to the university. Nowadays, when women for many years now outnumber men at all levels of academic studies, BA, MA, PhD, this seems like a ridiculous explanation. Now, I want to stress that the biological fact is still true. Men brains are on average larger still than female brains. But this is not the reason why women couldn't go to university or weren't in universities in the 19th century. And it's not that our brains grew larger, just that we were allowed to go to universities. Now, when we hear these stories from the 17th or 19th century, we laugh. But when we read this in the paper nowadays, we think it's true. But it's exactly the same. The only thing that changed is that now we have better methods to study the brain. So we don't talk about the size of the skull, we talk about connectivity, etc. But it's the same story. Assuming that there are male and female brains and using this to account for gender differences in society. Okay, so I want to stop here and leave time for Q&A. You have everything that we talked about here, and I want to thank you again for listening so patiently.